Damian's wife, she told me from day one she would never be in the movie. So, you know, eventually I had to kind of coax her in, and, you know, it's, and she's great in it, and it's great that she did it. Yeah.
So, yeah. I mean, it was a huge, huge important part.
Yeah, you have to have her. Yeah. Like, and she was like, it's not my movie, it's not about me. I'm like, it's going to be, so you're going to want to be in it. So I sort of like, yeah, I mean, obviously she's glad she's in it too, and we joke about that now. But, yeah, so, you know, pulling some of those other interviews and getting people to, you know, especially when you're trying to get them to talk about somebody else, you know, and you're not trying to say anything bad, but like, you know, that it always starts off with like, they're wonderful, they're great, blah, blah, blah. You know, we love them, they're the greatest people. And then you kind of got to get like, well, let's get more real.
Yeah. how long would that process be? Like, we talk with like Jones Brothers with, mm-hmm. with the Andy Irons movie, yeah. like interview Bruce for like 9 hours. Like,
yeah.
And Momentum Generation 2 would be like 9 hour interviews yeah. almost until they just gave everything that they had.
Yeah. I think it just varies person to person. I definitely didn't have to interview anyone for 9 hours. Thank God. I'd get it out. You know, so it's hard to say because like with these guys, we shot multiple interviews over and over and over.
It was always very, I don't want to say critiques, but one of the things about it was it would be a little jarring when you'd hear almost speak in the present, uh-huh. but you're like, oh, but that was a while ago.
Yeah.
That was like 2011 or whatever.
Yeah.
You know? And it was like, oh, where are we almost?
Yeah, that's what's tough when you shoot over that amount of time. It's, you know, you always try to be mindful of like, oh, don't talk about it like that. But you sort of, it happens. And then you're like, we can only pick, pick up shooting. So, and our whole thing was like, again, I didn't want to sit them down in one 9 hour interview in front of one backdrop. Like I was like, let's, you know, we took advantage of like every backdrop we could get. Like, you know, we're like on boats out in the ocean. So I'm like, let's get beautiful backdrops, you know, as much as we can. Let's take advantage of these locations we're in. So
did you see a lot of their competitive natures come out at all, like in the interviews even? Or did you see times when they would recollect something that happened in the past, but both of them interpreted totally differently? And how do you reconcile that?
No, they both pretty much kept on point with what happened. The only competitiveness would be like, it worked in our favor for the film. Like if one of them thought the other one was slacking and not doing his job, they'd be like, well, you need to step up. Like, what the fuck, man? Like, I'm out here, I'm doing these interviews, I'm carrying these cameras. Like, what are you doing? Like, now it's your turn. So that worked great for us. So it was all good. Yeah.
You had a twin specialist. You can give me a better title. She's a...
I think she's twin psychologist. Author. Yeah.
And that seemed like a necessary voice in there, given, you know, identical twins, the dynamics, the behavior development. Was that just an automatic from the go? What was, like, you were imagining her role in the storytelling or in the explanation of these two stars who happen to be identical twins?
Well, I think it didn't happen immediately, but as we started shooting and realizing we're really going to, you know, a documentary, you're documenting. You can think what you're going to make, but, you know, like, for instance, those guys that made Your Dreams of Sushi, they went out to make a documentary on sushi chefs around the world and then found him and was like, here's our film. So you have to give a little leeway with a documentary. So that didn't happen immediately, but I think once we realized, okay, yes, we're definitely going to dive into this twin thing more and more, that we were like, we need someone with an authority to sort of like just kind of give some background and some facts to their relationship. So I think we brought her in about halfway when we realized like, yeah, this is going to be a lot of information about twins in here. And honestly, it's fascinating. Like, you know, I did a lot of studying on twins doing this, and like, it's interesting because most identical twins, they become best friends and they do exactly everything together for the rest of their lives, or they, just spend the whole time trying to get as far away from each other and not see each other.
Yeah.
Well, these guys had a weird mix of that because they wanted to get away from each other and separate, but did the same thing. Yeah. So it's like, I think that's what was so interesting with their dynamic. It was a little bit of both, which isn't that common.
How did you decide what to keep in and what to keep out? There were certain moments in their careers, like CJ, you know, dropped off tour in 2011 and then came back on, and that wasn't really mentioned in there.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, how do you pick those? Was that from the focus group partially?
A little bit, yeah. But a lot of it's like, okay, do we have the footage to support it? There's also an amazing story of CJ won Sunset, and on the podium they said Damian Hobgood. And like, but we could not find the footage anywhere. So if you don't have the footage, you can't tell the story. So that was, that killed me, because I was like, that would have been so perfect. But we, I dug and dug and could, no one found it. But yeah, I mean, we tried to tell that CGA dropout. But again, when you're trying to tell a film that people that don't surf,
the qualifications,
it's like, it was such a like hard balance of like, how much can we, and no one is, as far as I know and as far as anyone has told me, like, no one's made a documentary on surfing and included like the world tour, which is funny because it's such a huge part of, if you're really a big surf fan, you follow the tour and you know about who's who and what rankings and, you know, blah blah blah, but no one's ever talked about it in a movie. And I'm like, this is crazy, like, why do we all kind of talk about it, but no one else has ever put it in a film? It's mentioned. They'll be like, oh, he was on the world tour. But the average person's like, well, what the heck is the world tour? So that always drove me nuts, too. So I'm like, you know what? I'm going to...
You gave a good explainer for it.
Yeah.
It
was, well, we had to. Like, it was like, how do we do this? We have to explain it quickly, just so top level, so that people watching the film that don't surf can go, okay, I can follow along. So, yeah.
Right, because the nature of the qualifications guided a lot of behavior and big life decisions.
Yeah,
and if you don't understand the weight of that.
Yeah, you're going, why? Oh, he's got to go to France? Like, oh, he's just going to, you know, after, you know, when the marriage falls apart, I'm going to go to France. Like, oh, but, you know, that, oh, no, he's got to go because that's his job. It's not, you know, this is how he's paying the bills. So, yeah, so, of course.
And I think overall, that's like, this is a surf, this is a documentary, it happens to be about surfers, but I think the complexity shown about what is, from the outsider's perspective, of like what seems like the ultimate dream existence is to travel the world to beautiful spots and surf, but it's like, it's gnarly, right? I mean, it's grinding, and the sponsorships aspect, the family dynamics aspect, and it's like, that's that I think is like what, that's good storytelling, period, but it's also like, that's good for surf stories.
Yeah,
right?
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because that's another thing I wanted to tell, is like, I mean, I consider it the greatest job in the world. That's an amazing, to be a professional surfer in the world is amazing, but as we all get older in life, we realize everything is a trade-off.
Yeah,
you know, and the trade-off of having that amazing job is you're gone 9 months. Do you bring your family with you? That's expensive. Do they stay at home? Then you're going to miss out on your child's birth, your child's first day of school, like all these things. So like, you want this amazing job, there's going to be a price. And I wanted to like show the price, and not that like, oh, it's terrible, but like, you know, just be real. Like, this is the cost that comes with this job.
It was great how you were able to show that. 'Cause it, I think a lot of people see it through rosy lenses, you know, like I even said to CJ, like, oh, I was envious of them, like traveling, but the movie really helped show like, oh yeah, no, there's a lot of drawbacks to this lifestyle, and this lifestyle is very decadent and selfish in many ways.
You know,
it can wreak havoc on your everyday, or not even your everyday life for them. That's the thing. It's like, what is their everyday life?
Exactly, yeah.
Going back to the family part, and we asked CJ about what his girls thought of the film, and they very much liked it, in part because of his ability to be honest and open up. Were you able, there's a lot of footage in the film of family and family videos. Were you able to speak directly with his either of their kids in a way that would like, hey, this is what it was like for me? I don't remember that in the film, so maybe that was not.
We shot some stuff with their children, but again, it's like, you know, how much can you, you know, you start with a cut. The first cut, I think, was like 3.5 hours long, so you have to start cutting it down. So, you know, and it's like, we put, again, we, I definitely wanted to have them mentioned in there because they're part of the story, and, you know, like, their life affects their children. So, you know, the archival stuff, a lot of it was from his parents, and Charlotte, Damien's wife, had a bunch, and then I had a bunch. But yeah, you know, the kids were around during, you know, shooting and stuff, but I think at some point towards the end, I think I said to Damien, I was like, and Charlotte, I'm like, do your kids, I think, oh, we were shooting the pickup shots at their house. I'm like, do your kids know about swimming? And they're like, no, we haven't really said anything to them. I'm like, well, you know, we're actually going to finish this thing, and you might want to.
Yeah.
And then I said that to CJ, too, because he hadn't really, you know, I'm like, I don't know where, you know, Genevieve, his oldest daughter, I'm like, I don't know what she knows about, you know, you and your mom's relationship, her, you and, you know, her mom's relationship. But, you know, this movie, you might want to preface it before she hits play, you know?
Yeah.
So, and then I think he was like, oh God. So that, you know, was a huge, you know, moment, you know? But it's funny because, like he said, it actually helped their relationship. So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What are you working on next?
Everyone keeps saying that. Honestly, yeah, I know it's funny, but like I'm
you
just
did a great job.
Yeah, thank you.
The documentary is definitely suits your style.
Thank
sure.
you. Yeah, no, I love it. I want another. I've had some people approach with some stuff, even in surfing, and some. I've got some ideas outside of surfing I want to do. I'm like, do I really want to keep doing surfing? I don't know.
That's the
but
question, right?
Yeah, I mean, there's some people like CJ and I'm talking, like Mick Fanning. I would love to tell his story. I don't think he's ready yet, but like. I don't even know him.
Yeah.
I just know him from we interviewed him. But like, just from what I know about him, just on the surface of what I know, it's got to be amazing. So,
is this now like a partnership with you guys? Are you both going to start producing other? Docs,
yeah,
think?
I mean, we started Sink or Swim Films as CJ Damian and I, and so we own the LLC, and we're like, you know, if it works and we can do another one, yeah, I totally do know, and it'd be great because they can be producers on it, and they have experience, and they can help bring things to the table. You
and
know,
I hear Dirk Ziff has a lot of money, so might be willing to pay for it.
So, yeah. You know, you talk a bit about the business behind Surf.
Yeah.
And you in part funded this through a public campaign.
Yeah. Oh, to answer what am I working on now? I think I'm literally in the last week been able to get in the mindset of wanting to do something else.
Yeah.
I keep explaining it like I just had a baby and now I'm raising this baby. So, you know, just doing this tour and just seeing, getting the reactions, like that's sort of, I've just been living in this for the moment. So, but nothing ready. We started on Indiegogo. We raised $85,000 and I knew that would never be enough to make a full feature. So it was either we're going to go make something short that we would put on YouTube or Vimeo or something like that, you know, or I don't even know. So, but when we started shooting, it was either that was the two roads. Either we're just gonna make a little quick something short that'll be a quick little doc and like that'll be that. Or if this story is good enough and I think we're getting enough content, we're gonna need to raise more money. So after Tahiti, we realized, you know, we got a chunk of these stories. I was like, we got a movie here. There's more than just a quick little film. There's actually more probably than we need. So. You know, so we started the process of, you know, I brought on producers and we brought on private investors.
Right.
And
you built the movie, yeah.
And that's honestly why it took five, six years,
right.
Yeah, is because a lot of that's raising money, getting to a point, and then having to raise more money. But I keep telling people, to be honest, if we had finished in a year, we wouldn't have this movie. Like, the length of time let the story unfold the way it did.
It breathed.
Yeah.
You know, it was you were allowed to really capture his capping off of the career and Damien's as well.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot happened probably in the last 5 or 6 years.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. That would have happened post movie, you know.
Yeah.
So you guys are tonight. You're going to screen it at the Wyeth Hotel here in Brooklyn
in an hour. By the way,
I better go.
Quickly, where else can people see the show in person? Is there other theatrical?
Let's see. We're doing the UK Film Festival,
London Surf Festival.
Yeah.
Member on.
Yeah.
You might get some good scores for me. I don't
okay.
know.
Yeah.
You know. Gotta
this is tampering, is it? So London and then Switzerland, it's going to play in Switzerland.
Right.
And then we just got asked to do Portugal, so I think we're going to do that. And then Santa Barbara. And there might be Puerto Rico. So if you go to our website, antoofbyc.com, like we put the showings on there. We're also probably, hopefully going to, fingers crossed, sign this distribution deal and hopefully have it digitally available by the end of the year, early, you know. 2020.
That.
So
thank
you. Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much, guys.
It's a beautiful film.
Thank
it's
you.
A really wonderful story. Captures everything. Like for someone who's seen surf films evolve, it's awesome to see the caliber of stuff that's now coming out.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really exciting. And thank you for doing this.
No,
that's
of course.
Great.
Thanks for having
Justin
me on here.
Justin Purser, director of And If 2xC, the story of CJ and Damian Hopgood.
Go.
Thanks, guys.
See it.
Cheers. I'm getting out. Now nothing ever shakes me.